What has been your biggest, I have to get the duck out of here as soon as possible life moment? I was walking home from work one night, when a man put his hand on my shoulder. I turned around, and he told me he was going to put me on top of a spiked, iron fence naked. I said, no thanks. Very loudly, and sped walked away. I didn't expect it to work, but he didn't follow me. I found a setup my stepdad had made in my room to record me after I was finished with a shower and was getting changed. This happened to me too. Worst day of my life. Mom's boyfriend. I found the camera wrapped in a t-shirt in my closet after I had just showered. I grabbed a knife and the camera, ran out of my house and drove to the police station. They had me call him and ask him questions to prove guilt. Found out later that he had been recording me for months. He only got 6 months in jail, served 3, then got deported. It's been 6 years, and I still don't feel comfortable going into a bathroom or private area without doing a quick inspection. I was walking home from the gym in Seattle, and I would always walk by this weird house with blankets over the windows. There was also fenced inside yard packed with old busted RVs and garbage. This particular night, there was an old dude with a long white beard standing in front of the house in a bathrobe, smoking a cigarette. I had never seen anyone in front of the house before. Then, I heard what sounded like a Prius pulling up to a stoplight, but was in fact several Seattle police cars rolling up with their engines and lights off. I don't even know how they got that quiet. Then I saw a few officers approaching the house and the old man, with their guns drawn. Completely silently. One of them made eye contact with me, and made a fairly violent hand motion for me to go a different direction. So I did, very quickly. About a month later that house was torn down. I have no idea what happened that night. And I'm glad I didn't have to find out. Obviously the police were going to fight the wizard and didn't want you to interfere. I had been sleep deprived for a few weeks, during a very stressful summer. To pass the time, I'd go for long walks late at night, sometimes stopping at a gas station or supermarket to buy a snack. One night, at about 3 a.m, I had a sudden urge to walk to a 24-hour diner at the edge of my neighborhood. I was hungry and needed the exercise. I walk in, and the place is largely empty. The waitress comes, takes my order and pours my coffee, then disappears into the kitchen. About 2 minutes later, the door opens, and a man in a trench coat walks in, pacing nervously by the register. I see him pull out a gun, and immediately my mind starts racing. I quickly conclude that there are a few possibilities. He is going to rob the diner and leave us unharmed. He is going to rob the diner and shoot everyone inside. He is just going to shoot everyone inside, just because. The waitress emerges from the kitchen, unable to see the gun from behind the counter. I'm the only customer who knows what's coming, and the weight of the world is on my shoulders. "Table for one?" she asks. The man shakes his head. "I'm here to see Jeremy." "Okay, I figure." He is here to kill Jeremy. Although I wasn't a target, it was horrifying to be sitting so close to what was about to become a murder scene. I braced myself as best as I could for the sound of the gunshot, as I sunk deep into my seat. I knew there was a good chance I'd be getting blood, skull, brain and hair all over my clothing. I was too close not to. What if he shoots me too for being a witness? Complete terror. There was nowhere for me to go. Should I remain silent when he kills this guy? Should I yell out a warning to Jeremy and risk getting killed myself? I clutched a very sharp steak knife on the table and went with my gut instinct. I was probably going to die, but I had to do this. I had to rush the shooter and stab him before he took the life of the cook. As I prepare to kill someone, Jeremy emerges from the kitchen with a wide grin on his face. "You must be Frank." Out comes a wad of cash, and up comes the gun, which is placed right on the counter. Looks even nicer than the pictures. Turns out they had met to sell/purchase a gun from a Craigslist ad. Most terrifying moment of my life. My ex and I have been divorced for 7 years. When she came clean and admitted she'd been seeing another guy for almost a year, had been sleeping with said guy, in our bed while I was at work, for a year. I noped out of there as fast as I could. It was no longer my house, as far as I was concerned. Our son is now 10. He was 3 at the time. When birthdays or other celebratory events come around, there's always one on mom's side, and one on my side. He has cousins and friends and relatives on each side. But I still always get an invite to a birthday party or whatnot from the ex. Why? I dunno. And every single time I accepted, and I sucked it up and showed up and sat around, and made small talk with Mr. New Boyfriend and all of their friends, because I'll be damned if I'd be the parent that triggered the, how come daddy didn't come to my birthday party, conversation. But every single one of these events was agonizing. Nails on blackboard, water torture agonizing. I mean, all I want to do is punch the guy, yet here I am talking about the weather and go-go local sports team. Usually, I figured if I made it past the cake to the presents, and my son is running around shooting Nerf guns at the other kids, that's good enough. Time to make my escape. My son thankfully, and at the same time sadly, put me out of my misery. Last summer, coming over the weekend before his birthday, he said to me, "Dad, here's mom's invite to my birthday party. It's going to be small, just, list of mom slash mom's boyfriend's friends and their kids. But I get it if you have other plans. I'll see you next weekend at place of my friend's house where we too will be having a birthday party with a list of his friends. That's the one I'm looking forward to." When the meth came out at a party that already had some nasty vibes going around. Went right over the backyard fence and out the neighbor's gate without saying goodbye. Same thing happened to me, but with crack. I walked straight out and got in my car. My friend called me judgy, and went back in to try it. He is now a crackhead. High school party, out in a field behind the host's house. All was going well, until some guy brought fireworks. Super dry season. Did not wait around to see what would happen. Heard the next day almost 2 acres went up in flames, and the OPP and fire crew paid him and his folks a visit. I was 9 or so, about to go wading in a creek, when I noticed a snake in the water. Just a little snake, maybe a foot long, just hanging out mostly vertical with its tail in some mud and reeds and stuff, and its nostrils sticking out of the water. Okay, no big deal. I just won't wade right there. I moved downstream 5 feet or so, and guess what? 2 little snakes right where I wanted to put my bare feet. And another one in the reeds. And, most of those weren't reeds. TLDR. I almost walked all over water moccasin daycare. Chechnya, in I think 1995. There were obvious a lot of those moments, but one that stood out was when I was walking back to the apartment block I was staying at, and I realized the entire block was not only empty, but all of the cars were moved out of the way, and there was a carpet laid out about 20 feet in front of me. I have no idea what was under the carpet, or why it was there, but it just felt so suspicious. And of course my first instinct is to run away. The second I turn around, someone from far away opens fire at me, presumably a sniper, but could have been closer. I then heard shouting and screaming for men to run and get me. The shouts were far away, they knew they weren't gonna be able to capture me. That ducking carpet, man. I won't ever forget that carpet. My biggest guess was they built a hole under the carpet for people like me to fall into. Then they would capture and rape slash torture you or whatever they would want. Lots of ducked up marauders and bandits in Grozny during the war. When I was in Iraq 2 years ago, visiting family, and ISIS took over my city. Nope, the duck back to America on the next flight. Is your family doing okay? Yeah, most of them were living in Duhok, and the ones that were in Mosul moved in with the family in Duhok. Generally they're doing well since they are protected by the Kurdish forces, but life in Kurdistan is shit right now. Everything is expensive, there are thousands of refugees everywhere, and Peshmergas are dying. Was in Japan for a solo vacation a few weeks ago. I got lost in Shibuya at like 3 a.m. in the morning, and needed to find a train station. Some creepy Nigerian dude pops up and offers to direct me to the station. Sure, I say, like the utter dumbass bitch I am. The guy takes me in the complete opposite direction. We end up at a hotel. He starts spouting bullshit about falling in love with me, and wanting to spend the night with me. Nope, the duck out of there and took a taxi instead. You'll regret that. Guy was probably a real Nigerian prince. hanging out with a friend and their friend and boyfriend in college. Bouncing around between parties. Turns out her friend's boyfriend was extremely Russian, and we end up at this party where there are more people not speaking English than speaking it. Had a pretty good time. The boyfriend comes back inside from the backyard. He suggests we leave immediately, because there's going to be a fight and it's going to be bad. I look in the backyard, and there are two guys screaming at each other in Russian, and the house is slowly emptying as people are running out back to take sides. Being in a Russian street fight is not on my bucket list. The three of us noped out real quick. I went to a summer camp. I have ADHD. Turns out my mom was confused with what special needs means, and thought it included ADHD. So me and the Tourette's kid got along pretty great, as we were the only two on the same level. Still the longest 2 weeks of my life. I was digging a trench in my side yard during a massive flood to get the water moving again. I heard a loud series of cracking noises behind me, and turned around to see branches falling off of a large oak tree. When the cracking got louder, I sprinted out toward the street. Twigs whipped my ears and back before I was safely away. So, probably that. When I was 12, my next door neighbor invited me to summer camp. Parents dropped me off. Realized immediately that the camp was odd, because the cabin counselor took away my copy of Jane magazine. Then there was a camp-wide assembly where we prayed over a photo of George Bush and spoke in tongues. Turned out it was a Pentecostal sleepaway camp. I walked to town and called my parents from a gas station. Every once in a while, your gut tells you something is up. I'm at a party, and get that tingling in my gut telling me I'm not okay here. I finally just decide to leave with a few friends to chill at my place. A few hours later, I get a phone call from another friend asking if I was okay. Apparently the house belonged to a guy who was affiliated with gangs. Some thugs tried to crash the party, and when they got kicked out, they started fighting people. A big fight breaks out, and a few people ended up in the hospital. Eventually the house owner brought out a gun and shot a few rounds in the air, and that's when everyone scattered away from the area. The cops were called, and people were arrested. Meanwhile, I left hours ago, and was currently playing drunk video games with a couple friends. Sometimes your gut's right. At an alternative club with my new boyfriend, I think we had been dating 3 weeks. Went to the bathroom, and the graffiti on the walls start melting, so I confide in new boyfriend. Turns out he put LSD in my pint because he wanted me to have a good night. If I wanted to have a good night on LSD, I would be on my couch, not surrounded by metalheads and emo kids. Cheers. A girlfriend of mine invited me to a business dinner. We were going to sit down with her coworker and a potential investor. The coworker had an ambition to start a fashion and beauty related company, and my friend organized the dinner to introduce the two of them, and allow her coworker to pitch to this guy. She asked me to join because she thought that I'd be interested in becoming a partner with the business also. Dinner is nice, talk is mostly on message about the idea, everyone is feeling pretty good. Then, after dinner, my friend suggests we go back to the investor man's house for coffee, because he lives like a mile from the restaurant. I thought it was odd, but I didn't want to dampen the rapport we had going. So we get back to his house and it's, "Who wants some wine? Take off your shoes, I'll put on some music, we can dance." "Oh, you're taking selfies?" "No, let me take the camera and I'll tell you girls how to pose." When the music and dancing started, I asked my friend why this business dinner had become so informal, and then she finally told me, "Well, I'm trying to set them up so he'll be her sugar daddy." Turns out my friend met this guy through a sugar daddy finder website. They'd met and talked, but my friend didn't really click with him. So she was introducing the coworker as a potential sugar baby, and he would fund her business idea in exchange for basically being his girlfriend. My, I need to get the duck out of here moment, was after like the 15th picture that the coworker said, "OMG, no, I still look like so bad. Can you take one more?" This 40-something dude casually says, "We should take some kissing pictures," trying to mask his excitement. I stone-faced replied, "That's not happening," and pulled out my phone to call an Uber. I live on a cattle farm, and one time my dad, Granddad and I had to move a bull into another pen so that we could give him medicine for his injured leg. To do this, we spread out in a fan with what are basically big rattles on sticks to make noise and get him to go the other way. When we get to the open gate, the bull looks at it, looks some more, and decides there must be a better way to go. He turns, faces us, we make noise to get him to turn around, and the cycle repeats. Finally he starts freaking out. He turns, faces directly at me, and jumps. I found my inner track star and climbed the fence to get away. Needless to say, we left him alone after that. When I was little, me and my dad went out to check a fire not too far away. He used to be with the police, and approached an officer, old colleague, on the scene, if he was right that it's a local firework storage that was on fire. He was right. That was the moment he decided we should get the duck out. Less than 100 to 200 meters later, the whole thing went kaboom, which is when I myself was like, duck this shit. I dropped my bike and just ran away. I remember seeing the shockwave knocking out the windows of all the buildings street by street. Which was cool, until the wave hit me myself. This was back in Russia when I was 14. I decided that it was a good idea to walk home from a party at 2 a.m. in a rural area. We had a summer home dacha outside of Moscow, literally middle of nowhere. As I was walking, a car pulled up, and a guy, looked to be in his 30s, asked me if I needed a ride. Being a moron, I said, sure, and got into his car. As he pulled up to the gates of our dacha community, he stopped and asked me if I wanted to come with him to a party. He was a construction worker in the area, with his friends. My heart skipped a beat, and as I looked at the car door to look for an escape plan, I saw that the door handle was missing from the inside, so I had no way of opening the door. At this point I felt my heart beating in my stomach, and I said, no, sorry, my mom is waiting for me. All of a sudden he said, well, mother is a sacred thing. You better go. He got out, walked around the car, and let me out. It was the last time that I hiked alone. I got insanely lucky that I wasn't murdered/abducted. On my last flight home, I sat down next to a nice looking woman. As soon as we were up in the air, she taps on my shoulder, motions for me to take my headphones off, and proceeds to ask me if I have time to hear about the Word of God. I spent a damn ass 7-hour flight trapped next to a Jehovah's Witness, learning about which Bible verses would solve my problems, because I was too scared to decline and risk smiting God while I was 40,000 feet up. When I was 19, my dad's girlfriend who just got out of jail for murder moved into our house. He didn't tell me she was out of jail/moving in. I moved out that day and couch hopped for a few months, because duck that. Edit. To answer some of your questions, they've known each other since they were children. I don't claim at all to understand what was going through his head, but as far as I understand it, she has him believing she is actually innocent. They were dating before this happened. She went to jail because she was a nurse at an elderly home. One day she decided it'd be a good idea to inject some old lady with insulin, killing her, and steal her credit cards. She's caught on tape at an ATM with them. That is literally all I know about the situation. No clue how she managed to get out early. I only learned these details from the local newspaper. Very hard for a 19-year-old to deal with. I was walking to a cafe when a group of oddly dressed people, one was wearing a cloak and literal pauldrons, and one had some sort of mask, very creepily invited me into their car. I did not accept. Get in, loser. We're going to Games Workshop. My work recently. I worked for a small family-owned business, and it was a mother and son operated store. They owned it together, and ran it for 30 years. A month ago, the mother passed away. My boss, the son, didn't close the store, and has cried in the lobby with other customers every single day since she passed away. He still tells everyone about it, and is rude to the people that didn't play into his pity party. We even had new customers, and he scared them off by telling them within 5 minutes of being in the store. Anyways, over the last 2 weeks, he's also been micromanaging like crazy, and is starting to progressively yell when talking to me or other employees. However, Last week he started wearing his mom's shop apron, started saying her euphemisms, and started eating her exact lunch. It's eerie because he's even starting to look like her. Yesterday, I walked into the office, and there's an urn in her desk chair. He said he placed her urn in her office so that way it's not like she ever left. The urn. Full of her ashes. In her desk chair. He then said, now we can say hi to her. I walked out yesterday after that happened, and didn't look back. Edit, there are a few comments calling me insensitive. In some aspects I can see why some of you think so. As much as I care for this boss, there's only so many ways I can try and help him. Hell, we've all been trying to help him, and he's not being receptive to it. I know he's going through a rough time, but this is a professional workspace. His emotions were causing him to be unprofessional, and he was starting to become hostile, such as his yelling. The situation was showing signs of getting worse, and for my own safety, I thought it was best to leave. It's a sad situation, but I don't regret it.